You don't need to be that drastic. What?
The mic is hot.
Yeah. Well, church, good morning. All right, let me hear you say that again. Church, good morning. All right, there's a little life here. Thank God for that. Friends, I want to welcome you this morning here to worship at St. Paul's. My name is Evan. I'm the pastor here. And I extend to you a special welcome if you're visiting. Welcome those worshiping online with us as we come to God's house today to learn more of Him and to grow closer to one another. Melissa is going to come and share announcements this morning. Melissa?
Good morning, all. Just a few things for you. There's lots in your bulletins, lots and lots to remember and to look up. Just a couple of announcements we want to make. Also, remember, if you have prayer requests in your pews, there are prayer request forms. Those will be collected during our time of offertory. Something in your bulletin that's not collected during offertory, but if you would like it filled out and would like one, the Mustard Preschool is doing the mum fundraiser. So that's to get your fall mums. We are almost in official fall, so you want to get those fall mums for your decor. They'll be collecting these down by our Norcross Hall where our fellowship is between services. So if you want to fill this out and get your mums, it's in your bulletin. I'm sure they have extras if you need more as well. The other thing we have announcement for is our church picnic. The Women of St. Paul's are hosting that next Sunday. That is next Sunday at 2 p.m. So that's September 22nd. Hamburgers and hot dogs will be provided as well as beverages. So you just need to bring your favorite picnic dish. There's still a sign up in the narthex as you exit the church if you would like to sign up. Otherwise, you know, bring your favorite dish. And if everybody brings a similar dish, we'll have a contest. It'll be fine. Whose is the best? Another thing to remember as we get into fall, you're changing from summer to fall. Do you have some summer decor that you don't want? You're going to look at your fall decor and then say, ooh, I don't like that anymore. Well, you can donate it to the rummage sale, which is coming up in October. October 5th is the actual rummage sale, but the 4th would be a drop-off day for anything that you do not want to have in your home anymore. They don't take large furniture, but they take all of your like home goods, your decorations, paintings, things like this, and clothing, of course. So as you change your attire and change your closets, if you're like, oh, look, I lost a lot of weight. I can't wear this anymore. That's great. Or, ooh, that doesn't fit anymore. So let someone else enjoy it. You can give it to the rummage sale. So just remember that's coming up as well in October. There are a lot more in your bulletin. We have lots more online on Facebook as well as our website. If you would like for more announcements, we have tons of Bible studies starting up. We have lots and lots of information. So please stay tuned, and you can always ask us if you want to ask for something specific. Let's take this time to quiet our hearts and prepare our worship with our prelude. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we lift this time up to you, this time where we worship together, where we're able to lift up these songs to you in your name, where we're able to look into your scripture, your word, Lord, be able to apply it best to our hearts and lives. Let us take this time to be present with you, Lord Jesus Christ, present in this time of worship and present in your presence. We lift today and every day in your holy and precious name. Amen. Please join us for our first hymn of praise, Where Cross the Crowded Ways of Life. This is in your United Methodist Hymnals 427. Again, that's your red hymnal 427. The words will also be on the screen behind me. Please stand as you are able. You may be seated, and the children can come up if they'd like for the children's sermon. All right. Oh, there she goes. Hello, hello, hello. All right. So, hi, everybody. I have some questions for you, and I think you'll know how to answer these. First of all, what is your favorite color? You said you didn't want to answer.
Light pink and baby.
Light pink and what?
Baby blue.
Baby blue, okay.
Baby blue.
Baby blue.
Pink.
Pink.
Cyan.
Cyan, okay. Let's get specific. All right. Oh, I see Robert's hand. Okay. What's your favorite color, Robert?
Red and green.
Okay, I like that.
Yellow.
Yellow. Ooh, that's different, all right. Jack?
Golden, dark blue, and emerald green.
Ooh, okay. Very good. Okay, now, here's another question for you. What is your, if everybody has one, what's a favorite sport, either to play or to watch?
Basketball.
Basketball.
Soccer.
We'll come back.
Karate.
Karate.
Woo.
Karate.
All right. Sometimes he joins me.
Football.
Football. There we go.
Soccer.
Soccer.
Olympics.
Like all the sports.
Okay.
Chess.
Chess is a sport. We'll go with it. A mental sport. Okay. So I have two more, a little bit more specific questions for you. Do you have a favorite brand of clothing or shoe? A lot of people do. Like there's something you like. That's something you like.
I like sneakers.
So sneakers are a thing. Is there a favorite brand you like? I know that's like a weird one. Or a favorite piece of clothing you like to wear?
What do you got?
Sandals.
Sandals, very good.
High heels.
High heels, woo, I love it. All right, so one more question. Not by name of person, but do you have a favorite friend? Yes, okay, don't name the favorite friend. Don't name it, don't say it aloud. We know that everybody's got favorite friends. Sometimes people say they have a favorite kid, but we won't go there because some of them are siblings. So, here's the thing though. Jesus teaches us a lesson about favorites. Here's the thing. Those things were your colors, what you like to wear, what you like to play, what you're interested in, that's all about you, your personality, which makes each and every one of you different. And that's really great. But God puts in the scripture today that no one is a favorite in Christ's eyes. In other words, no one's above anyone else. Because maybe someone can't afford to play the sports you do. Maybe someone can't afford the shoes that you like or the type of jeans you wear. Or maybe they can't afford the food places you like to go to. But that doesn't mean they're not just as special to Christ. Because in the Bible verses today, what they're talking about is how some people with money seem more important. With more stuff, they seem more important. But this is what they teach in the book of James. It says that Christ must show no favoritism, that you have to love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show favoritism, it's like breaking the law. So this is why we don't show favoritism, that we see everybody the same in Christ's eyes. So even though we're special and we have individual things that make us special, whether we have all the money in the world and we could play all the soccer or we could go to the Olympics or we could buy all the high heels in every color, no matter what, God loves us all individually, all the same way. All right, let's pray together. Dear Lord, help us to love others as you love us. Amen. You can go to Sunday school.
As our kids leave for Sunday school, let's stand and greet each other this morning.
Please join me for our morning prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, as we come before you this Sunday, which you have made, we acknowledge that you're not only God of creation, but also God of mercy, grace, and forgiveness, and worthy of our praise. Forgive us and free us that we might listen to your voice and empower us to recognize the sin in our lives and turn from that sin by the power of your Holy Spirit so that we can have a closer fellowship and walk with you. Your word says in Jeremiah that you delight when we know you as a God of kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. And we're not really sure how you're able to do all these things, but you are, and we praise you for that. You're an awesome God, limited only by our ability to understand. Lord, this day, this hour, we choose to lean on you. When we are at our weakest, your strength is strongest. Help us to use your word, which Paul describes as a sword of the Spirit against the wiles of the devil. God, your days are without end. Your blessings and mercies to us are beyond counting. Help us always to remember that life is short, and we need your Holy Spirit to lead us in life that is holy and pleasing to you. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. We pray for friends and family members who do not know Jesus. We ask that you would open their ears and their eyes and their minds to the truth of God's love, mercy, and grace found in Christ. Bless those gathered here today and worshiping online with us as we come together to encourage one another in love and good works. Lord, as we continue our worship throughout the week, remind us that we are blessed by you so that we can be a blessing to others. Please guide our efforts, decisions, and conversations so that all that we say and do will bring glory and honor to you. Close our prayer today with the words Jesus gave his followers when they asked him to teach them to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come.
As we give back to God a portion of his generosity toward us, I'm going to invite our ushers to come as we receive this morning's offering. You can give in our offering plate. There are also ways to give electronically that are in your bulletin. We give you thanks as we give God thanks for all he's done for us. Ushers.
While they're getting things ready up here, this is just a song I wanted to sing for a while now. And basically, we can see God's blessings each and every day of our lives. Sometimes we don't even recognize them. This song just goes, tells you a little bit what to expect when we are up there in heaven with God. Ever had those times when you feel so small? On a starry night, as you stand in awe, have you climbed to the mountain's edge? And the world you find makes you catch your breath. If you think that this is the best that it can get, Oh, the wonder of it is, you ain't seen nothing yet. Just hold on, hold on. It's a butterfly's when she says I do, and the babies cry in a world brand new. It's the arms that are holding you, and the moment when all your dreams come true. If you think that this is the best that it can get, oh, the wonder of it is, you ain't seen nothing yet. The sweetest sound yet to be heard, still you know you wanna hear it more. Oh, we long, long to return to a home we've never seen before. If you think that this is the best that it can get, oh, the wonder of it is, you ain't seen nothing yet. If you think that this is the best that it can get, oh, the wonder of it is, you ain't seen nothing yet. Just hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. So much more than our wildest dreams, so much more than what we've ever seen.
As you're able, please stand as we give God thanks and sing the doxology.
Gracious God, we praise you and thank you for all the many blessings that you've given us. Use the gifts we give today to expand your kingdom in this ever world that is in need of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, let us stand together and sing our next hymn of preparation, Have Thine Own Way, Lord.
Yielding. People have been up here. Our scripture reading from the Old Testament today will be Psalm 146, and it's page 980 in your Pew Bible. But before I begin reading, let me just say a short prayer. Lord, we thank you that you have given us the gospel to learn about you, and we pray that you would open our hearts and minds today to listen to the message that you wish us to hear. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praises to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed are those whose hope is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow. But he frustrates the way of the wicked. The Lord reigns forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord. And our New Testament reading will be from the book of James, chapter 2, verses 1 through 17, page 1881 in your Pew Bible. My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, "Here, a good seat for you," but say to the poor man, "You stand there or sit on the floor by my feet," have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers and sisters, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking it all. For he who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not murder." If you do not commit adultery, but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Here ends the reading of the word.
I want to make just a brief announcement. As you saw, I'm a hymn singer today. God help us all. If you're a guy here in the church and I'm not even going to say if you've got a good voice. If you have a voice and you like to sing, I want to recruit you maybe for the choir or to sing Sunday morning on some of the hymns. I know we could use some more good strong male voices, and you'd do us all a favor if I don't have to do it. We want to invite people to church, not scare them away. And also, you know, we could use help with the volunteers if you're interested in helping run the PowerPoint. There are a lot of pieces on Sunday morning to be able to have our worship service and all the pieces to come together. So if you're interested in either helping with the music ministry or helping with our PowerPoint, talk to someone and the word will get to somebody. No. See Dave in the back, in the sound booth. He's waving at us and you can let him know. Friends, would you pray with me this morning? Holy Spirit, come into this place, into our lives, into its inner recesses, and fill us and form us and make us holy and completely. We are yours. Meet us now in this place, in Christ's holy and precious name. Amen. When I was in college, I was very involved in a local camp meeting association. Had roots in the Methodist Church, but at this point, it was made up of folks from all sorts of Christian denominations. And every summer, there was a series of camp meeting services all throughout the week, starting on Sunday night and culminating on the following Sunday. And just a few years ago, well, it was 8 years ago, I guess now, I got the chance to preach that one summer all weekend. That was really wonderful. Well, long before that, when I was in college, I was there attending. And on Friday night, which was kind of the a pinnacle of the camp meeting, the Friday night service, it was packed. There was a lot of live music. And just as the minister, I forget who it was who was preaching that week, some visiting pastor from out of town, just as he was getting up to preach, there was a noise in the back of this rickety old building. They called it the Tabernacle. It's an old wooden building with wooden benches. And the door slid open, and in walked a woman that, well, let's call her Crystal, and her boyfriend. Crystal had a reputation in the town. This was one in a long line of boyfriends that she had with her on her arm. And as the minister was about to get up to preach and the door opened, you know, there was just enough silence, and that door was just creaky enough that everybody spun around to see who it was. Oh, there were gasps that rippled out among the congregation gathered there that Crystal, of all people, would be there at a church service. It was shocking to a lot of them. And I noticed as she walked in looking for a place to sit in a packed tabernacle, people either didn't make eye contact or they tried to shuffle away, or, you know, sometimes how you put your stuff on the very empty open seat next to you, as if to indicate this is taken. Judy, then she's saying with her water bottle in her purse and her phone and her glasses. Yeah, all of that. Well, finally, she found a spot kind of near the front, over in the corner by the side. And some folks, when she sat down, got a little bit closer to their neighbors on the other side. And I'm sitting in the back and I'm taking all this in. Well, the pastor got up to preach, and it was a Friday night service, so there was an altar call. And he had preached a particularly emotional sermon, he had gotten folks ready to make a response for Christ. And guess who was the first one up there at that wooden rail? Crystal. Boyfriend in tow. And I watched the response from the folks there. You know, body language can tell us 90% about a person. I watched some folks go up to her and hug her and cry with her and put their arms around her. And I saw other folks not even look in that direction. And then I saw folks who were kind of caught in the middle. What should I do? How should I feel about what's happening right in front of me? Well, that pastor who was didn't know who this woman was also got down there and knelt beside her and started praying for her. And then I saw something shift in that whole congregation. Slowly people started to go over and surround her and pray for her and hold her hand. Even some people who had shown either indifference or outright animosity when she walked in that building just a few minutes prior. I even heard one woman say, because Crystal hadn't spent a lot of time in churches or religious gatherings, and how do I say this politely, frankly, did not know how to dress for the occasion, an older woman went around her and said, come on, let's go, let's get you cleaned up. Come on, you could come back to my house tonight, and I'll get you a good meal. It was a beautiful moment, but it was also a bit of a distressing moment for me to see so many people who I knew, who I'd grown up in church with, who professed Jesus, and when a woman, regardless of how she had lived her life, was clearly at the end of herself and the end of her rope, and found consolation in a message of hope in the gospel, came forward to make a response, some people just still didn't want anything to do with her. What I saw that night was indicative of what can happen among the people of God, and that is favoritism towards some and rejection of others. I dare say if you've been in church long enough, you've probably seen that play out. Whether it's the way someone's dressed, maybe it's their reputation, maybe, horribly, it's based on something like skin color, age. I've seen it happen. I saw it happen that night. But I also saw people in real time having their hearts changed and softened towards someone and started to embrace her and love her as Christ embraced her and loved her. No doubt there was something similar happening in the church to whom James wrote his letter. Perhaps in James' day it was more divided along the lines of rich or poor. But in the early church it also happened in terms of male and female, Jew and Gentile, economic status, where some were treated differently than others among the Christian community. And as you can imagine, the rich, the well-off, the famous, those of good reputation, it seems to be that in the early church, those were the ones who were favored. They were given special status. And it was the crystals of James' day, the poor, the outcast, the marginalized, who were ostracized and made to feel lesser than. Oh, the people in James' day in the churches may not have said it with their words, but they showed it in their actions, that they clearly favored some over others. And James reserves some of his harshest admonition in all of this letter toward those who showed favoritism. As you recall last week, James, in the introductory chapter, he talks about the ability of the Word of God to take an individual who's humble, to shape them, and then set them free. And remember, freedom is not the ability to do whatever we want to do with our lives. Freedom means the ability, the choice, to choose what God wants for us and to follow His way. And James starts to talk about how that looks in a community of faith. How an individual who's been set free by the good news, how then they're supposed to act and behave in a community, and what that community should look like. And he talks about justice, care for the orphan and the widow, and then also morality and ethics. And he brings those two together, and he does again in this chapter. Some churches I have found in my experience will emphasize moral teachings. Don't commit adultery. Don't engage in this activity. Don't murder. Really, don't do that one. Especially, perhaps, don't do that. Some churches will emphasize the moral teachings of Scripture and not often talk about the need to take care of the poor and to be merciful to those on the margins and to help those who are less fortunate than us, to take care of those who need to be clothed and need to be fed. And then there are other churches who talk all about the need to take care of the poor and justice and works of mercy, and yet askew the Bible's teaching on morality and ethics. James holds them together. He says they're meant to fit together. They're not at odds. The moral law and the just law of God go together. And James is particularly concerned with favoritism, which he links as really a failure in both, in morality and in justice. What is favoritism? And why does James speak so harshly toward believers who were practicing favoritism in their church? Favoritism, at its core, is a rejection of the image of God in another individual. Because at the foot of the cross, what happens? All of us become equal. It's a level playing field. The need, from the richest person in the world down to the one who is most destitute, is the exact same need. And the cross levels the playing field. And so for a church to show favoritism toward some and a rejection toward others is to deny the image of God on that other individual. It is to look down upon what God has done for them. James reserves harsh language toward those who would show favoritism. And then James starts to talk about the relationship between our faith and our works. Now, throughout church history, there have been some who have looked at, say, for example, the teaching of Paul and these words in the letter of James and have seen that, have perhaps thought that they're at odds with one another. Because Paul talks about being justified by faith, how it's a free gift, how there's nothing that we can do to earn it. And here, James says, faith without works is dead. They're not opposed at all. If you have a beautiful tree outside, how do you know if it's alive or dead? The foliage, perhaps the fruit on the tree, the flowers. Are the fruit and the flowers and the foliage the life? No, they are evidence of the life of the tree. The same that James says with faith and works. Faith with works, works don't save us. Works show that we are saved. It is the evidence, it is the fruit of a life that's been transformed. And so James, linking favoritism and particularly concern for the poor and the marginalized, the crystals of the world, with faith. And that how we treat the poor among us, how we treat one another, is evidence whether there's faith or not. When James talks about taking care of the poor, and there does seem to be in all of Scripture that God has a tender heart toward the poor. Why is that? So often the poor, the destitute, those who are at the end of themselves, know their need. They've tried everything and they've realized that it just isn't working. We find all through Scripture, in the Old Testament, in the book of the prophets, in the people whom Jesus encounters, who were most receptive to his message. In the book of Acts, it is the poor, the lowly, the despondent, the destitute who rush to Jesus, who embrace his message because it's good news for them. And often it is the well-off and the rich who are most hesitant. And yet it seems in James that it was those folks to whom the church was showing favoritism. So what does this mean for us? For those of us who've come together in a community of faith seeking to follow Christ, how does this play out for us on the ground? Well, first of all, we should heed the warning. Favoritism was present in James' day, and it's present in our day. And how easily it is, friends, isn't it, to slip into favoritism of all kinds. Maybe it's coming into church and only talking to the same people every single week. Not intentional favoritism. But James is asking us, how can we be more hospitable? How can we be more welcoming to everyone? So that everyone has the opportunity to experience the grace of Christ. Maybe it's even in our day, folks in our community, that we might look askance at. That we might not give the time of day. Individuals may be in our heart against whom we harbor something. James challenges us to examine ourselves and to make sure that favoritism hasn't taken root in us. And that we have an eye toward those who are needy. And when James talks about showing mercy, he's not just talking about an attitude or good words. In fact, he indicts that in chapter 2, doesn't he? He says, come on, what good is it if you say to someone who's in need, oh, I'm sorry, have a good day. James says, if we're not actually, tangibly seeking to enact mercy, to meet the physical, the spiritual, the emotional needs of those around us, then we're failing to keep the law of God, to keep his commandment. So we examine ourselves, we take stock of our hearts, and then we don't let it stay there. Because friends, James is all about what? Putting knowledge, faith into practice. Not just being a hearer, but also a doer. So when it comes to the need of those around us, what are we doing in our own way with what we have, with the resources God has entrusted to us individually and as a church? What are we doing to show the mercy of Christ to those around us? Because Jesus says that there'll come a day when everyone is standing before God, and they'll be sorted into what? The sheep and the goats. And he'll say to the goats, you didn't give me water. You didn't feed me. You didn't visit me in prison. You didn't clothe me. And they'll say, Lord, when did we see you in need of any of that? And Jesus will say, as much as you didn't do it to the least, you didn't do it to me. And he'll go to the sheep and he'll say, you fed me and you gave me water. You clothed me. You visited me when I was in need. And they'll say, when did we do that, Lord? And he'll say, when you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. Those good works do not earn us salvation. but they show evidence of a life of faith, whether it's real or whether it's just so much words. Jesus is still looking for his people to be people of mercy. Let's do what we can to bring his mercy into the world around us. Amen. Friends, as you're able, I invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn, Jesu, Jesu. You'll find it on page 432 in your hymnal. Friends, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. And all the people of God said, Amen. Amen.